سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. أما بعد، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Second and the last session of this presentation, interest rate research in the US. Just a quick reminder, the last thing we discussed and concluded yesterday was the permissibility of using credit card for those who live outside the land of Islam in a society like the US where there is a general need for the credit card. We said this permissibility is stipulated with the correct use of the card. In other words, you have to, whenever you decide to hold a credit card, then you have to avoid any transaction that mandates or necessitates paying riba, like for example, delaying your payment in full after the due date. This will necessitate paying extra money. They call it late fees, but from our perspective, it is riba. If you go with the payment plan, if you go with the minimum payment, for example, the $1,000 that you owe the credit company will not stay $1,000 anymore. It's going to increase or multiply, and this is another kind of riba. If you go with the cash withdrawal, for example, you will be charged twice. You will be charged for the service itself, which is fine. So one time charge for the actual service for bringing you the money, which is fine, whether it is a fixed amount or percentage of the actual amount you withdraw. And the other charge is the interest. So the other charge, the interest one, is a prohibited one. So if you have to withdraw cash money, do not use your credit card, use your
debit.
So we're on the same page. So let's proceed from here. Paying service fees for the cash withdrawal, okay, that's covered already. Now the fact that the credit company discount the payment or the point of sale receives 97-98% of the actual amount is halal. It has nothing to do with riba. In fact, it's the opposite of riba. The three involved parties, the merchant, the client, which is you in this case, I mean the credit card holder, and the credit company all agree, directly or indirectly, that the total amount will not be paid, for there will be some deduction, some service fees, which is, you know, the opposite of riba. It is halal. Someone asked yesterday about the credit transfer. I said that if the new company, the hosting company, the new one, charges you zero APR, that will be fine. Although you have to pay some credit transfer fees. Sometimes they link it with the actual amount. They ask for a certain percentage, which makes the charge very suspicious. I mean, why they ask for a certain percentage? It's in the same nature of riba. So if you're going to transfer, for example, $10,000, they charge you $100. If it is only $1,000, they charge you $10. I mean, the connection between the actual amount, the actual debt that you want to transfer from one company to another with a certain percentage makes it very, very suspicious. This is the same nature of paying interest. However, since it is justified as service fees, it could be overlooked. It's more prepared to go with a fixed amount of money, regardless, I mean, as a charge, as a fees, it's more prepared to go with a fixed amount of money. So for every single credit transfer, they charge you, say, $50 or $60, regardless of the actual amount that you transfer from one credit company to another. This is actually something more prepared. It gives you a peace of mind that it's a real and actual service fees. It's not a percentage of the amount, which is, you know, against the nature of riba that you always try to avoid. The security credit card actually is not that different from the traditional one. It is issued for those people who do not have credit history. If you apply for a credit card, for example, for the first time, without having any credit history, your application would be rejected because the credit company does not know what kind of person, you know, you are, how much you are committed a puncture in your payment and so forth. So they're not prepared to take a risk and give you a line of credit or give anyone a line of credit in which they do not know what kind of person he or she is. That's why they go with what is called a secured credit card. Secured credit card is simply you pay the amount as a security deposit. You pay the amount or the exact amount that you want to have a line of credit for. For example, if you prepare to have a line of credit $5,000, for instance, then you have to pay the credit company $5,000. Now, with this in mind, do you think that this this transaction does it take the same rules of debit card or credit card? It's credit card and it's not debit card for a very simple reason that if you, for example, if you pay those $5,000 and you spend them already, if you want to cancel that credit card, you still have to pay them back the $5,000, and then later on, you'll be receiving your security deposit. You see? So you are not withdrawing from the actual money that you are depositing in your account, technically. It's not the same nature of like a debit card. Debit card means that you have an actual money, you put it in the bank, and then you withdraw whatever you want for whatever the reason might be. This is something different. Although outward might look like the same, but it is different. What you pay is a security deposit. So after the end of the contract between you and the company, which is in most cases from 12 to 15 to 18 months, you will be receiving your money back after building some score, some credit history. Up to this point, actually, the security deposit or the secured credit card takes the exact rules of any other traditional or regular credit card, which you already covered yesterday. The only difference here is that by the end of the contract, you will be receiving a certain amount of money. We appreciate your business. Thank you for having credit card with such and such a company. And they pay you back some money. This money actually is a pure interest. It came from different useless transactions that have been conducted by the company itself, because they know in advance that those $5,000 will stay in their position for 1 year, or 15 months, or 18 months. So it's not wise, business-wise, to keep the money actually deposited in their account. They reinvest the money, and as an appreciation, they give you a certain percentage from the riba that they made. It's preferred for you, it's highly recommended for you not to use this money. Although you are not the one with the decision of investing this amount of money in haram, but again, stay on the safe side and get rid of the money by giving it to anyone in need for that amount of money, other than your dependents, your parents, your kids, or the people that you are financially responsible for. Avoid those people and give the money to whoever you want. Do not use the money for yourself or for your dependents. Debit card is different. It's just a way to facilitate and to give you a peace of mind. Instead of going to the bank, physically and withdrawing money, you just can use it in any point of sale. When you hold a debit card, it means that you have a checking account. So you are withdrawing from the halal money that you have in your account. Definitely it is mubah, there is no riba. Even when you are charged like service fees. Service fees actually is a service fees. It means that the ATM machine charges you whether from the bank itself or from the subcontractors or those who buy the ATM machines and have the business with the bank, you will be charged a certain amount of money. This is an actual fees for the actual service that you are enjoying. Instead of going to the bank and getting your money, somebody else is doing the job on your behalf, so he or she is there to be compensated. So there is nothing wrong with it. The only thing you need to be careful about is what's called the insufficient fund. You need to check your balance every day, or at least before you use your debit card. If you know that you do not have sufficient fund, then do not use your debit card. Because if you choose to do so, then the bank, in most cases, would process your purchase. Say, for example, you have only $400 in your account, and you made a purchase of $500. The transaction actually will go through to be approved. But if you want to reinterpret this transaction from a fifth perspective, how do you justify, or you know, what is the definition of the extra $100 has been paid by the bank? You have only 400. You made a transaction or a purchase of $500. Who paid the 100 extra? The bank. Now, when the bank charges you overdraft fees, what kind of payment, what kind of charge is it? What do you think?
It's a
loan. I mean, it's the $100 paid by the bank is a loan. Although it's not technically defined as a loan, but again, as I said over and over many times, we need to reinterpret any transaction, any contemporary transaction, put it in a fiqh perspective. When someone is paying on your behalf $100, it has no interpretation other than to be a loan. So the bank actually is lending you those $100. I'm just reinterpreting the transaction from a pure fiqh point of view. You have only $400, you made a purchase with your debit card of $500. It went through. It means that the bank already paid from its own pocket $100 on your behalf just to let the transaction go through. So you owe the bank $100. If the bank is asking for overdraft fees, then it has no interpretation other than to be written, because this is a loan contract. Okay, the bank paid $100 and you will be charged 20, 25, 30, even one single penny means it is written. So just make sure you do not overdraft your account. If you do not have enough money, do not purchase. Double check your balance before you decide to make any purchase or any transaction. There is a service called overdraft protection. If you pay it, if you agree to pay it, which is I think $5-$7, automatically withdraw from your account. It will protect you against any overdraft fees. It will protect you against any overdraft fees. It's not riba. I mean, even if you pay $5-$7 per month, you do not know in advance how much you will be benefiting from the service. You might, face the overdraft situation, and you might not. That's a kind of jahala and gharab. Jahala means uncertainty. You do not know whether or not you will be benefiting from the service. Al-gharab means it's very close to jahala. I mean, the uncertainty of the actual amount that you will be benefiting, even if you get involved in overdraft. You do not know whether or not you will be having overdraft fees or not. You do not know how much money you will be charged. So the fact that you are paying $5 or $7 automatically for no well-defined compensation for those $7 will make a lot of jahala and ambiguity and uncertainty. And that's why it is preferred to avoid. If you choose otherwise, it's not an explicit haram option for you, but it's not preferred because of the ambiguity and the uncertainty. There's another kind of card that's called the multiple card, which is a credit and debit card at the same time. In reality, it's a debit card, it's not a credit card. However, it gives you the option of using it as a credit card for a reason or another. Sometimes you go to a point of sale in which the debit card is not accepted. See? So you have to use it as a credit card. Sometimes you need, or you prefer not to be charged immediately. And you all know, I mean, if you make a purchase with your debit card, you will be charged immediately on the spot. If you check your bank account, you will see those purchases already reflected in your account. Unlike if you do a transaction, unlike if you use it as a credit card, it takes from 2 to 3 business days sometimes to be reflected in your bank statement or credit card statement. So if you want to delay your payment, you use it as a credit card. If you want to make a transaction, a point of sale in which debit card is not accepted, you can use it as a credit card. Now, the fact that a debit card is used as a credit card does not change the reality or the nature of the transaction. So at the end of the day, it's not a credit, it's a debit card. So all the rules and the regulations, the guidelines applied for debit card are applied here. If you have an extra money and you want to invest, saving account is not an option for you to start with. Because yesterday we made ourselves clear that the two different kinds of haram are well known for us. There is something called haramun li ghayri, something that is directly prohibited by itself. And the other category, which is less worse than the first one, is haramun li, haramun li ghayri, something indirect, prohibited or prohibited because of its potential consequences. Now, let me ask you this question. If you want to interpret over a loan, you are putting a certain amount of money in the bank. What is the, what kind of transaction is it from a fiqh perspective? What do you think? Now, by law, your money is put in the capital, the amount that you deposit is protected. Okay, it is guaranteed. And a certain percentage that the bank gives you is guaranteed. Do you think that this transaction has any other interpretation other than to be an interest-bearing loan? Any other, I mean, think about whatever you want. It has no interpretation other than to be an interest-bearing loan. Someone might ask, is the bank poor and needy enough to borrow money from you? The answer is no. The bank actually has millions and millions of dollars. But who said that the borrower always the poor one? Again, when it comes to any contemporary transaction, it has to be interpreted according to the fiqh code or fiqh standards. So when someone is giving someone else certain amount of money, and that amount of money is guaranteed, it has to be returned back, and there is a repair on that amount that is guaranteed by law, that this is the nature of the loan, and definitely this is an interest-bearing loan. So to start with having a saving account is not an option for you as a practicing Muslim. What kind of haram involved in it here? Is it haram li dhatihi or haram li ghayri? Now, mashallah, you became from Bahrain, huh? What do you think? Haramun li ghayri? Who said haramun li ghayri? Okay, when you get involved in it, you know from day one that you will be getting a certain amount of money. So this is a direct involvement in getting agreement. From day one, you know that you will be receiving 4.5% APR. Do you still think that this is haram on your lady? It is haram on that. You are directly involving yourself in getting agreement. This is haram on that. And we said yesterday many times that al-haram lidati tubihuhu. Wrong answer. Al-haram lidati tubihuhu. Whatever is prohibited by itself, directly prohibited, could not be permitted unless there is a necessity. Remember, necessity is a very, very desperate, very dire need. It's almost life or death situation. You see? بينما الحرام اللي الحرام الحرام لغيره تبيحه الحاجة الحرام لغيره تبيحه الحاجة. Whatever is indirectly prohibited or prohibited because of its potential consequences would be permitted in case of need. There is a big, huge difference between al-darura and al-haja. Al-darura is the necessity, al-haja is the need. Al-haja is the need. Now the question here, if we agree that saving account is haramun lidati tahrima maqasid, do we think that there is al-darura? I mean, there is no other way for us to invest but to have a saving account? Is there any darura involved here? Is there any darura involved?
No.
Okay, say yes or no?
No.
So, since there is no darura, then a saving account is not an option to start with, period, bottom line. Someone has an extra money, okay? And you want to save that money, definitely he's not a shame because you try to injure not have much money. If someone has extra money, you want to invest, okay? You want to save the money, okay? If he thinks that this is the only way to save the money, then he is wrong. You can open another checking account. You can open another checking account without releasing its information. Say, for example, if the main purpose behind opening a saving account is just to save the money in a safe place, then other checking account is the solution. And there is no possibility, believe it or not, there is no possibility of identity theft if you do not release the information of that checking account. You can have two different checking accounts. One for the day-to-day transactions to pay your bills and do your daily purchases. You can just put there a few hundred, a few thousand dollars. and the big amount of money, you can save it. Again, the only purpose of having a saving account is just to save the money, then you can put it in a very safe place called checking account and not a saving account. As long as you're not releasing the information if you're checking account, then your money is saved, and there is no possibility of identity theft. Once you start using other account, then it might be like accessible or exposed to other parties, or the possibility of identity theft might increase. If the main purpose behind opening saving account is not to save your money, but to make investment, then you have many choices. I mean, do not limit yourself, do not put yourself in a box and just limit yourself to saving account. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it easy for you. You can invest directly, you can establish a partnership with anyone in your community who is interested in establishing a certain business. You can contribute, you can buy some stocks, you can have a mutual fund. I mean, alhamdulillah, there are unlimited options for the halal investment. So do not make it hard for yourself where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it easy for you. Checking account is on the opposite of saving account. Whenever you decide to make to have a checking account, which is most probably the case for many of us living in this society, because this is one of the most convenient ways of facilitating our daily transactions, is to have a checking account and to have a debit account. Is that true? So whenever you decide to do so, you have to make sure that the checking account is free of interest. Is it possible that you get interest out of having checking account? Yes. There are some checking accounts nowadays that some banks are designed in a way, as long as your money is saved in that checking account, not saving, checking account, you will be taken premium. Automatically you will be added to your account. And it's better for you to go with the free of charge, free of interest checking account. Free of charge is not a must. I mean, you can pay to the company or to the bank $12-$10 per month for the service of having a checking account, and there is no ribbon over it. But you have to make sure. You have to make sure that it's free of interest checking account. Someone might say, well, if I have a checking account in a conventional bank, then in a way or another, I'm helping and facilitating for the bank doing more and more haram business. Well, that is true. But there is no other Islamic alternative. That's absolute. I mean, you have a very bad point. And practically speaking, statistically speaking, more than 60% of the deposited amounts in the checking accounts are not touched. Untouched money. So the bank will not just keep watching the money. Definitely the money will be lended to other people for interest. So directly or indirectly, you are helping the bank conducting more and more haram business. That is true, but there is a need for it. I mean, you cannot ask people not to have checking account and save their extra money or savings at home, تحت البراقي مفهوم السمك ولا مش عارف somewhere else. It does not work. We have to be practical. So having a checking account is permissible. Once you have an Islamic alternative, believe it or not, having a checking account, free of charge, free of interest in a conventional bank becomes
haram.
Haram. Becomes haram because there is an Islamic alternative. There is ayah that you don't know, وَمَنْ يَشْفَعْ شَفَاعَةً سَيِّئَةً يَكُنْ لَهُ كِفْلُ مِنْ أَمْرَةً Interceding or participating, committing a sin, will be shared its punishment. Financing means referring to a third party or somebody else, or not paying for it. Put it this way: when you say financing here in the U.S. and in the industry, finance is not to pay for it; it's to pay down payment and to make a payment plan. Whether you are financed by a third party or by the other contracted party. Sometimes if you want to buy a car, for example, they do something that's called in-house financing. Is that right? In-house financing means that the buyer himself, the car dealer, and make a deal with you, so you pay him directly without involving a bank or credit company when there is no third party involved. So just to start with, the word financing means, finance is making a payment plan or paying an installment, sometimes by referring to a third party, sometimes by having a direct agreement with the other contracting parties. Now, I want to emphasize the point here, that here, that offering different prices for the same commodity, for the same merchandise, okay, based on the duration of the payment, or the payment duration is halal and not haram. And that's something we have to start with. I have a car that's worth $5,000, it's for sale. If you are interested in my car and you do not have $5,000 cash, that's fine. I can sell you the same car for 1 year payment plan for $6,000. If you are interested in 2 years payment plan, I'm going to make it $7,000. 3 years, $8,000. 4 years, I can give you unlimited options. Okay. Up to this point, the transaction is halal. You know why? It's a very simple fact. If the car that's worth $5,000, if I want to pay it for $6,000 cash, is it haram or halal? Isn't it my option? I mean, this is what I'm asking for. I'm asking for $6,000 cash. You buy it or you steal it. So if I do have the right to ask for $6,000 cash, why don't I have the right to ask for $6,000 for 1 year payment plan? What's the point here? I do not see it. You see? So offering more than one price for the same commodity based on the installment or the payment plan is halal. However, the transaction has to be concluded, or there must be a closing based on one option. You cannot just take the key and start the engine and just take the car. We'll talk to you later on. It does not go this way. We have to finalize where to go only and only with one option. You want this car for 2 years, it's going to be $7,000. The monthly payment or the periodical payment is such and such, the duration is 2 years. All the rules and the conditions for the sale contract has to be well known and agreed upon from the beginning. It's $7,000 for 2 years. Done deal, we do the closing. It's $6,000 for 1 year. It's $8,000 for 3 years, whatever the amount and the installment or the payment plan might be. Is this point clear? Now, when we say that financing, or having or offering, not financing, offering different prices for the same commodity based on the duration of the payment is halal, it does not mean that this fatwa is a very general one. It has to be limited to certain guidelines. When we say it is halal, we have to make sure that there is no late fees involved, because late fees is avoid condition in the contract. But it does not invalidate the whole transaction as we explained yesterday. Because late fees is not haram, it's not haram li dhati tahrima maqas, it is haram li ghayrihi tahrima wasal. It is prohibited, indirectly prohibited because of this potential consequence. So it does not invalidate the whole transaction if you have it in the contract. If you have no choice but to have it in the contract, then that's fine. Because there is a need for that. We cannot stop people from financing because there is a late fees minute in the contract. It's a standard form. I mean, it's a template. That's called the al-fiqh al-uqud al-id'aq, the dominating contracts. I mean, we have two parties, the strong one and the weak one. And usually the client is the weak one. This is the standard. This is the contract. You take it or you leave it. So having late fees in the contract is not the ideal situation. However, it does not invalidate the whole transaction. Now, the other condition for the permissibility of financing is not to have a third party that is financing for this transaction in a traditional way. Traditional way means that the third party would pay the price of that car. Now, example, you would be happy. You do not have $6,000 for one year. So you go to a bank or a credit company and you ask for a loan. Okay, so the bank, after checking your credit history, and your income, your income, your credit history, upon the approval of your application, the bank would pay me as a seller $6,000 in your behalf. Okay, with no ownership involved in this transaction, meaning that the bank does not own the car. The bank actually would play the role of the lender. The bank would lend you the money, but instead of giving you the money cash, you would pay me the amount in your behalf. And definitely you get back to the bank and pay more than $6,000. Now, whatever is paid more than $6,000 will be counted as riba. Why it is riba? Why it's not profit? Because the bank did not own the car. Because the bank did not own the car. The bank actually was lending you the money indirectly by giving me as the seller. I get the money on your behalf of the bank. And you get back to the bank, you pay him $6,000 plus the APR, the lenders. And that's why having a third party financing traditionally is prohibited. It doesn't mean that any kind of involvement for any third party is not. No, it's not. I mean, we can finance systemically. We can go with the murabah style. We can go with the lease to purchase style. We can go with the hijara one. Alhamdulillah, we have 3, 4, 5 different modes of finance that could be applied for this particular transaction. But the way that it is done here in the U.S., like any other or most of the countries, actually, it is done traditionally in a very formal, in which the third party is playing the role of the lender. The bank is lending you the money, and you get back to the bank paying $6,000 plus extra. Well, this extra money has no interpretation or justification more than to be able. Even if you go, for example, to the car dealership itself, can we open the floor for question and answer a little bit more. If you go to a car dealership, say for example in Toyota, you're gonna have a 0, 0, 1. You want to finance through the Toyota finance. Some people think that Toyota finance and Toyota car dealership are the same entity. So there is no third party involved. If Toyota finance, for example, charge you 3 APR, there is no haram because I mean, this is way of tafsir. This is an installment, sale. Believe it or not, it is not. Toyota finance is an independent, financially speaking, legally, administratively speaking, it's completely independent entity that has nothing to do with Toyota car dealership. To the extent that if someone went, bankrupt, the other one can just operate normally as if nothing happened. They are completely independent. Now, the fact that they hold the same name or they work for the same mother organization or mother, company does not mean that they are the same company. They are not. So if you finance with a certain, APR with Toyota Finance, then you are involving yourself in riba. Again, because Toyota Finance would lend you the money and pay it to Toyota car dealership on your behalf, get back to them with the exact amount plus, extra money, which is riba. How about the special offer of same as cash for 5 years, zero APR? I mean, that's fine. Even if there's a third party involved, that's fine. You go ahead and just take advantage of the any zero APR, which means that someone is willing to give you an interest free loan for 5 years. Obviously, there is a late fees, but again, over and over, the late fees is haram, لغيره تحريم تحريم وسائل that could be permitted because of the general need for this transaction. So zero APR is haram. There are some ways to circumvent the rules and the regulations. Okay? It's a very legal. I'm not saying anything illegal. Even if there is no zero APR, you can sometimes persuade or convince the car dealer to change the deal. I mean, even if he's asking for 3% APR, you can just offer him a good amount of money as a down payment. Okay? And believe it or not, I mean, he will agree with you, he will change the deal and give you zero APR. I want you to remember something very important, that those people at the end of the day, they are business people. You are just selling the contract. So if you give him a good amount of money as a down payment, he might just change the whole contract for you and give you something else with zero APR. If the 0 miles, you know, car that you're interested in worth $20,000 with 3% APR, if you give him $5,000 down payment and ask for finance with zero interest, with zero APR for the next 4 or 5 years, he will agree with you. I did it myself. You see? Again, at the end of the day, they are business people, they are just, you know, sell, they are willing to, you know, work around your, you know, rules and regulations and restrictions that you have as a practice you see. Another solution is called capitalizing the interest. I mean, this is another way, another legal and Islamic way to, like, circumvent the rules or take an exit and make, you know, or permitting the transaction. If, in our example, if the car that you're interested in worth $20,000 with 4% APR, then you have to pay, let's say $24,000, make it very simple, okay? Now the other way, or, you know, the capitalization of the interest is to make another agreement, is to increase the price of the car. So you make a deal with him that this car, I'm willing to buy it for $24,000 with zero interest. You see? It might look silly, honestly. But this is a way, believe it or not, this is a legitimate way to permit the transaction. If the car worth $20,000, I am willing to buy it for $24,000. You see, if you just, you know, eliminate the, you know, the APR and make it zero interest. I did it once a few years ago. I went to a car dealership to buy a car, and I went through the same scenario. So it was something, ridiculous for the, you know, car. How comes that you want to buy the car for $25,000, although it's worth only $20,000? I said, well, I am good. I have some, you know, religious restriction. He said, okay, wait a second. Let me talk to my manager. So he went all the way to his manager, and after half an hour, the manager came himself, and I explained to him the whole story one more time. He said, hold a second, let me talk to my boss. So he went back and talked to his boss. His boss talked to the 911, and the police talked to the FBI, and then they came back to me and said, okay, that's fine, we'll give it to you. So they changed the deal. They made it $25,000, zero interest, instead of $20,000, with 5% APR. Is it certainly halal? Yes. Is it the ideal way of buying cars? No, it's not. But this is what I can do as a Muslim. I can just capitalize the interest, put the interest on top of the price and change the whole deal. Make a $25,000 instead of $20,000. Alhamdulillah, it's perfectly fine with no riba involved in it. For the car dealers, there is an offer they receive from the wholesalers. That's called the floor plan. Do you have any car dealers here? Floor plan. Floor plan means a line of credit for a certain amount of money. You as a retail car dealer, you go to the wholesaler. Okay, you take a line of credit for $100,000. You go to the, you know, to the lot and just, you know, pick up the cars that you want up to $100,000. Okay? And you take a grace period of 45 days to pay the $100,000 in full with no consequences, with no riba at all. However, if you fail to pay the amount in full within the 45 days, that's fine. The cars are used. But from that time on, you would be charged penalty, service fees, interest, whatever you want to call it. You see? So if you limit yourself to 45 days, the possibility of paying the wholesaler in full might be a little lower. And the possibility of paying the riba will be very hard. You might not be able to get rid of all these, you know, cards within only 45 days. So a solution or a possible solution is to increase the price and increase the grace period. So instead of, it's the same concept. Instead of paying $100,000 for those cards, okay, you should show the card, you know, the wholesaler willingness to pay $105,000 in order for him to give you 90 days or 100 days grace period instead of 45. What kind of difference it makes? It makes a big difference. Now the price is well known and agreed upon from the beginning. I mean, those cards that you are taking are not for $100,000, they are for $105,000. And the grace period is long enough for you to, you know, sell those cards and to pay, you know, the $105. It makes a difference. See, and this is a legitimate solution for this problem if the wholesaler agree to. Lease to purchase is a good option for those who are looking for cars with good qualities, low mileage, free maintenance, free oil change. To start with, actually, there is no possibility of having riba involved in it, because we said yesterday that the two only transactions that are subject to riba are ahd al-bay' wa ahd al-dayn, the sale contract and the loan contract. So if there is no sale contract, if there is no loan contract, then to start with, there is no riba. Someone might say, well, the bank from, or the car dealership from behind the scene, they sell the car to the bank that is financing the car, or the car will be sold to the bank. Well, whatever is done from behind the scene is not my job. Now, what I'm doing as a leasee, okay, I have an agreement, a lease agreement with the car dealership. This car, BMW 2010, for 5 years, the monthly payment is $225. Okay. Now, if they want to check my credit history and my income, that's their job. Because I'm not signing any sale contract. Consequently, there is no possibility of any riba to be involved. Just a lease contract, regardless of what they do from behind the scenes. Is this point clear? It's a lease contract, and the lease contract is not subject to. If you choose, one of the sisters asked me yesterday, withdrawing from the 401k, that we have two different options. Well, first of all, the 401k is a federal program to help people securing a good amount of money or a good income after, you know, reaching the age of retirement. So withdrawing from your 401k would violate, you know, the spirit of this program. However, if you choose to withdraw from your account, that's fine up to a certain limit, but you will be charged. Sometimes interest, sometimes penalty, sometimes service fees, and you have, generally speaking, you have two different ways of withdrawing from your 401k account before the due date. The due date could be disability, could be death, could be reaching the age of retirement, 60, 65. What is the retirement age here in California? 60? 67, 65? You don't know? In Texas, I think 64. So the first option is taking an interest-bearing loan. You borrow from the investment company, which is, say, for example, Fidelity. Okay. Now, they call it a loan just because of tax evasion or tax reduction purpose. Let me put it in my school. Tax reduction purpose. It's a very legal way to avoid paying tax by taking a loan, because if you take a loan from the investment company, whatever you withdraw is tax-free. You see? Now, the question here, what is the reality of this tax action? Are you really, really borrowing money from the investment company, or you are taking from your account? You are taking from your account. So even though it is called loan contract, this is a very important point, by the way. It supports the same concept that I discussed with you yesterday. الأمرة في العقود بالمقاصد والمعاني لا بالألفاظ والمباني. What is considered in transactions in Islam is the reality of the reality and the nature of the transaction, not the name of it. So the name of this transaction, legally speaking, is a loan. You are borrowing from the investment company. But the reality is otherwise. You are not borrowing. You are taking from your action, from your halal. And that's why taking a loan and being charged interest is not haram. You know why? Because you are taking from your money. And the interest that you would be charged by fidelity would be paid back to whom? To your account. So you are taking some money from your right pocket and you put it on the left one. It's just a way, I mean, to circumvent or to avoid paying tax when the money will draw out of money. You see? So it is called loan. It is called an interest-bearing loan, yet it is halal because it's not a loan to start with. Now this is one option. And the other one actually is to withdraw from your own account. In this case, you will be charged penalty. Penalty will be paid, will be given either to the company or will be paid back to your account. It doesn't make a difference because to start with, you are explicitly taking money from your personal account. So in both scenarios, actually, there is no riba involved or whatever. How to invest in your 401k plan? In most cases, you will be given maybe 3, 4, up to 5 different options for investment. And if you do not have those options, then you need to do some lobbying with the Muslim employees in your company, and you know, talking to the investment company, try to make a deal with them. I mean, to design a portfolio, especially for Muslims, you can easily do that if you. Put some pressure, do some homework and lobbying here and there. Generally speaking, they give you what is called the stable value fund. It's a kind of saving account. They call it CD. CD, I mean, you put it, you have a saving account with a very low interest rate, but it is stable and secure. 2 to 0.5% to stand against the inflation and give you some profit. This is definitely not an option for you at all because it's an interest-bearing loan. It's a kind of saving account. Another option is called the balanced fund, 50% like stocks and 50% bond. It's not an option because having a bond means that you are lending the federal government or Uncle Sam a certain amount of money. That's not an option for you. Third one is called the aggressive stock fund, which is a halal one, as long as those stocks belong to companies who conduct halal business, or the minimum, or the haram, or the percentage of the haram in their business is going down to the minimum, to be more practical, more realistic. Because if you are looking for companies who have 100% halal business, you are wasting your time. So you go with the minimum haram involved in their business, the minimum, as long as the core business is halal. Say for example, Sam's Club, Walmart, what do you think? Holdings, stocks for Walmart, haram or halal?
Haram.
Haram. Haram. Haram.
Because they don't pay their suppliers on time, they really squeeze them. So it's not an ethical social enterprise.
So that's why it's haram? How about the nature? How about the core business of Walmart? Is it a liquor store? Is it an item bomb? Is it a conventional bank? Is it a tobacco company? Is it a musical instruments company? Or just a grocery store with some haram items?
I can say all of the above.
No.
Because when you walk in, it's...
No, wrong answer. It's a grocery store. Walmart is a grocery store. It has some clothes, some hygiene here and there, but at the end of the day, it's a grocery store with some haram items. They might have maybe 50, 60,000 different items. Maybe 1, 2, 3% of those items are haram, like purely haram, liquor, and some pork products. But at the end of the day, the most of their inventory is halal. Okay, just to proceed with our presentation, holding the stocks for Walmart is halal. Okay. Why? Because their core business is halal, although there is some haram forward. So you should not exaggerate by saying, okay, they offer, you know, liquor in Portland, their business is haram. No, it's not. Okay. This is mal muhtaram. This is amal muhtaram. It's a mixed trade or business. It has a lot of halal and some haram. So if you're looking for stocks, pure halal stocks, 100% that belong to companies in which they are not involved in any haram activities, you are wasting. Okay. And the fact that is now became very, very prominent and well known for issued by contemporary scholars, even by fiqh councils, that dealing or transacting or trading with the stocks is halal as long as you are going with the minimum percentage of haram involved, as long as, again, the core business of that company is halal. Okay? So, for example, holding stocks for a conventional bank is haram, for a liquor store is haram, for obscene materials is haram, for tobacco is haram. Anything that is haram by itself, you cannot hold it, it's a stocks. So this is an option. I mean, from three and up, you can choose. Aggressive stock fund, international stock fund. Fund-wise, it doesn't make any difference. Instead of having your portfolio, having stocks for the national, within the nation, within the US, they just diversify your portfolio and create stocks from overseas. It doesn't make any difference as long as you're abiding with the criteria that you mentioned. And the fifth one is just to have a plan. Sometimes they call it ESOP, which is to invest in the stocks of the company that you work for. Well, with the assumption that you work for a company that has a halal business, Intel or Apple. This is a halal business. Definitely there's a certain percentage involved in haram and riba, depositing money and saving account and investing in a haram thing. But overall speaking, Apple or Intel or some other Microsoft company or whatever the company might be, their core business is a halal. Those are the restrictions that we need to take into consideration. Any guaranteed profit, as long as your profit is guaranteed, and to start with, this is not an option. Because as we explained yesterday, there is no guaranteed profit in Islam. No way for your profit to be guaranteed. I'm not talking about being employed by a company, getting your salary, no. I'm talking about being owned in business. So if there is a guaranteed profit for your business, then to start with, the business is not halal. As I said, holding stocks for companies that hold the haram business, like obscene materials, alcoholic, tobacco, gambling, whatever is haram. Here in the U.S., there is a category of investment companies that's called socially responsible fund companies. Socially responsible fund companies. They have their own software program. They can classify the index or the list of companies based on the actual percentage of the haram involved. Some of them are conservative, secular. Some of them are conservative and students of knowledge, and they always follow up with the mashayikh and read the fatawa and abide with the fatawa of the mashayikh. And some of them are very, very liberal and very loose in their practice. One of the good companies that I recommend for those who want to have mutual fund is called Al-Azad Fund. Azad, A-Z-Z-A-D-F-U-N-D. Okay. I mean, the one in charge of the owner of that company, I know him in person. Alhamdulillah, he's a practicing Muslim, so he went to college. Maybe sometimes he called me in person and asked certain questions in investment. So my assumption is that his company is more compliant and more strict when it comes to choosing from the index or from the companies to invest in. Very loose. They deal with the stocks of insurance companies. They do not have a Sharia advisory board, they have no students of knowledge, they have no regard to nobody.
How about the companies' debt ratio? They talk about less than 5%.
I will open channel with you all 4% or something.
Before proceeding, could you just repeat the name, please?
Z-A-Z-Z-A-D. There is a man, I don't recommend, there is a Islamic dialogue, it's part of maids. It's the same, I mean, very liberal, very Muslim, your application. Okay. I discussed this topic in details today on the housing. Anybody was there in the meeting that we had?
1, 2, 3, 4.
So do you want us to skip this topic or just to, what do you think?
Summarize?
Mind the house like Mr. Morgan.
Summarize?
What's that?
Can you summarize?
I cannot summarize it. I talk a lot.
We want to go through it.
Especially when I have a rice campus. Sorry?
Yeah, we want it. I want this topic.
Okay. You are going to buy the house? Can I see some hands? It's everywhere. 10 minutes? Why not we save those 10 minutes for question and answer instead of going through this topic? Okay. As we said many times, that in order for you to pass or to make a fatwa or a judgment on a certain transaction, you need to analyze it. You need to reinterpret that transaction from a fatwa perspective. So when you say that so-and-so person, for example, has bought a house and registered a mortgage, what does it mean? How many transactions involved in it?
Two.
Two, three, four. Okay. When there is a mortgage deal, it means that three different transactions that are fully integrated together are conducted, I would say, simultaneously, like at the same time. You do a sale contract, and there is a loan contract, and there is a mortgage contract. A sale contract means that there is a deal between the landlord and you as a client, as a buyer. So you buy the house from the landlord, right? This is a sale contract. And the second one, if you do not have enough money, or even if you do, but you are financing it through a third party, it means that that third party is lending you the money indirectly by paying the price of that house in full on your behalf to the landlord. So this is a loan contract. Is that correct? And in order for the third party or the mortgage company to secure their money, they just put a lien or put a hold or they mortgage the property. So you end up with having a deed under your name as an owner and the name of the mortgage company as a lien holder. So this is a very nice combination of sale contract, loan contract, and the mortgage contract. Now the sale contract by itself is fine. وَحَلَّ اللَّهُ بَيْعًا وَحَرَّمَ الرِّبَا. And the mortgage, believe it or not, according to the Islamic definition of mortgage, is a halal one. Mortgage actually is the one that's mentioned in the end, toward the end of Surah Al-Baqarah, وَإِنْ كُنْتُمْ عَلَى سَفَرٍ وَلَمْ تَجِدُوا كَاتِبًا فَرِهَانٌ مَخْبُوضًا. A rihan means mortgage. Mortgage like to put a lien, or to mortgage, or to put a hold in the property of the borrower in order for you to secure your money. I mean, this is a very common practice in Islam. As a matter of fact, it's even simple. I mean, if you want to borrow, for example, $10,000 from me, I can ask for your car to be mortgaged or to be lien for me. I can put a lien or mortgage on your car until you pay me the $10,000, in full, and then I can just release the lien. So definitely, we do not have any problem with the sale contract. We do not have any problem with the mortgage contract, but we have a problem with what?
The loan.
With the loan. With the loan. Now, is it true that one boy transaction that is mixed with two other halal transactions would be more than enough to invalidate the whole transaction? Yes, I mean, this is something haram. Well known to be haram. This haramun, haramun lidati tahrim maqasid. Because someone actually is borrowing with riba from the mortgage company. And that's why we strongly believe that buying house via commercial mortgage is haram, because it is an interest very well, as simple as that. It doesn't need a lot of speeches and philosophy why it is haram. It is haram. The sale contract is halal, the mortgage one is halal, but the loan one is haram. So this is the analysis we say mortgage. This is what we mean by mortgage. Now, is there any way to, not to say a complete transaction, to Islamize this transaction? Well, definitely there are many ways that we can, many ways. One of them is called the Aqd al-Murabaha. Aqd al-Murabaha is to approach the Islamic bank or even the conventional bank and ask for a certain property to be sold for you. I mean, show interest to sign a document, like a promise to buy that property whenever it is bought by the bank. So upon your request, the bank would buy that property. Definitely the bank can ask for down payment, for example, just to assure, you know, your seriousness that you want to proceed with that transaction. You pay, for example, 5, 10, 20%, whatever they ask for, and they conclude that you are closing on the house, so the house would become the bank's property. Okay? And then a different and independent transaction, they would sell the house to you with a higher price. They buy it for 100,000 upon your request, and they sell it to you for 150,000 for a long-term payment plan, 20, 25, or 30. That's called murabaha. And the other one is called al-musharaka al-mutanaqisa al-muntahiya bitamliq, the diminishing partnership, which is the, I mean, housing model. They ask for 20, I think, or 30% down payment. They buy the property jointly, I mean housing, and you as a client, and upon a pre-agreement, you start buying their shares on a monthly basis. Whenever you pay, they ask you to pay the fair rental value of that house. Okay, whatever is paid for their share will be taken as a rent. Whatever extra you pay will be going toward the capital. You are buying their shares. So you start with 30, 70. You keep paying until you switch, until you become 70% owner and they 30% owner. They stop, they reappraise the property, find out whether it is appreciated or depreciated, and they adjust, you know, the payment accordingly. Definitely throughout the whole agreement, the whole partnership between you and the mean housing, they share with you the profit and the loss. There's a serious expenses for maintenance, something serious, I would say maybe more than $400 or $500. They will show it, you know, based on their proportion and the property. They pay the tax, the property tax with you jointly because they are part. This is another model for financing. There is a third one that's called ijara. Ijara mutahibita. Ijara is to buy the house on your request by the bank, and they sign a lease contract with you for 10, 15, 20 years. Upon the completion of that contract, if you were consistent and punctual in paying them on time, then the whole property will be transferred to you. That's called ijara mutahibita. Sometimes they transfer the deed for $1, sometimes for $0. Just a nominal amount of money you pay in order for you to buy the house. After that, they collect, you know, all the rent for 20, 25, 30 years. There is no limitation, there is no restriction. It's all about, you know, supply and you know, as far as the price and the, you know, fair rental value, it's up to you and the financing. So this is the Islamic way of financing house. What is the similarity between murabaha, musharaka, muntahib al-tamliq, or ijara? The most important thing that we need to understand is that there must be a real and actual ownership. And ownership actually involves what? Involves collateral, involves risk. When I mean housing, buy a house, it means that Allah forbid if something wrong happened to the house, was, you know, destroyed, stolen, broken, I mean a hurricane came and just destroyed everything, who would be incurring the loss? The owner. And the owner in this case is I mean, how so? So there is an actual ownership. There is an actual and real ownership. That's what the Prophet ﷺ said. نهى بيعي ما لم يكن. He prohibited Muslims from selling before possessing. What's the point behind, you know, behind possession? It is the collateral. It is the risk. We are not looking, you know, for what for you to lose as a company, but you have to take the risk. You have to be, you know, the property has to be under your collateral. If something happened to it, then you are responsible. And because of taking the risk, you are entitled to take a profit. Okay? See the hadith? نهى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم عن بيع ما لم يقبض. صلى الله عليه وسلم Muslims from, you know, selling before possessing or owning. And the other part, وعن ربحي ما لم يقبض. As well as he prohibited Muslims from taking profit without taking risk. There must be a risk involved in any transaction, in any trade, any business you make, in order for you to be entitled for profit. Those are some of the options that Islamic housing companies or Islamic holding groups have to. Okay. Are we done? I say السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. السلام عليكم. Do you think that buying foreclosed houses take the same rule of traditional mortgage process, or there's a difference between the two? There is a difference. When we say that this house is a foreclosed one, it means that the previous or the initial client already defaulted. He failed in paying his mortgage for 3 consecutive months, and consequently the bank took over the property and foreclosed it. So the owner of this house from now on is the bank, and the previous or the original client is just kicked out. Or maybe already left the house. So we ended up with having a house that is owned by the bank. That is owned by the bank by law. Now, the bank basically is not a construction company. It's not a business company. It's a financial company. Their main job is to lend money, right? But they get stuck with the house because I mean, this is the law. I mean, they have no choice but to repossess the property because of the default or the failure of their client. Now, if you want to buy this house, the foreclosed house, probably with the owner of the house, countrywide, for example, they will ask you to sign 2 different contracts at the same time: a sale contract and a loan contract. Sale contract because you are buying a house, okay, and a loan contract because this is the common traditional common practice. They have to involve some loan because this is their main job. For liability in front of the General Assembly purposes, for selling the or securitizing, you know, the contract and selling it to Freddie Mac or whatever the major financing company might be, because this is what they do. I mean, they just collect the, you know, the deeds together and sell them for another major company. They get their money back and keep conducting business. I mean, this is the way that they run their business. No one has billions and billions of dollars and can wait for 20, 25 years in order for the money to be paid back. This is what they do. They're just recycling the money from one entity to another one. So by law, the bank, the owner, can ask you for a sale contract to be signed at that rate. But practically on the ground, they refuse to limit you to a sale contract. You have to sign a loan contract and a sale contract. Here's the question. If you decide to do so, do you think that this transaction is a halal or a haram?
Haram.
Haram.
Halal.
Halal. In between. If there is a loan, it is haram. That's why when we discussed this, you know, this issue within the fatwa committee, I mean, this was the answer of 3 different respected scholars in the committee. They said exactly, there is a loan contract, it's an interest-bearing loan, it is haram, which is a very valid and appreciated opinion. However, my very, very humble opinion is that this loan contract involved here is not a real one. It's a nominal. It has no reality. To start with, the bank is not even interested in lending the money. The bank actually has a thing called gold house. They want to just get rid of that. They want to sell the house. So the bank is not interested in lending the money. The bank is interested in selling the house at the end. However, to be in a compliance with the corporate taxes of banks and a financial institute, they ask for a loan contract to be associated with the sale contract. So the money is not a real money. You do not have to receive money. You cannot take a decision on how to spend this money. Okay? The money will not even be under your collateral. There is no actual money, just the paperwork you sign. Okay? And they do their own amortization calculation. The house that worth $100,000 will become $150,000 because of the so-called interest for 10, 15, 20 years payment plan. To the best of my knowledge, the total amount, the capital, and the interest, they should be put together, and the total amount will be the price of the house. So you are buying a house from Mr. Countrywide for $150,000 for 10 years. There is no riba involved, and thus this transaction is halal to the best of my knowledge. I have, I think, one of two different members in the federal committee who supported my veto, and they said, yes, your opinion is correct. One of those members actually is Dr. Hussein Hamid Hassan. Sheikh Hamid Hassan actually is the head of MCA. Now, Sheikh Salah Al-Sawi, the Sheikh of Sheikh Salah Al-Sawi, we consulted this issue with him, and we submitted a very short report about this transaction. He said, what Dr. Mann adopted is correct. This transaction is fine. From within the federal committee, we have Sheikh Waleed Minasi from Minnesota. I think you know him. We have two or three different members who said there is a loan contract, it's haram. Another two or three members, they are involved, they did not adopt any opinion with them, yes. Among those on hold, my sheikh, Salah Al-Sawi, is still, you know, undecided. Long story short, buying a house or those house from the owner of that house, is halal, even if you have to sign a loan contract and a sale contract. Wallahu a'lam.
As long as the payment is just divided, okay, it's
Allah. Okay, we'll start with some questions.
You mentioned about
before I forget, excuse me. Some brothers and sisters yesterday asked if we offer this presentation a course. Yes, we do. We have Al-Qudah University in Houston, Texas, and for this semester actually I'm teaching a course called Transaction 1. It's not, this is 2, this is the intermediate. I'm just teaching the basic one, and it's too late to join for this semester. If you are interested, you can join for the next semester. If you need to get more information about the university, we have those brochures and postcards. Sorry.
About the stocks, you mentioned that halal companies are okay, not involved in alcohol and tobacco and that, but there is also the debt ratio, and usually a lot of companies invest in debt. So doesn't that make the stocks...
Investing in what, I'm sorry?
In debt. Like selling accounts, or there is what they call in the financial term of the company, the debt ratio, which is how much the company is investing in cities, for example.
It has something to be taken on a case-to-case basis. We cannot generalize the fatwa, but what is almost agreed upon is that if the core business, this is the very general guideline, if the core business of that company is the halal, and number two, if the haram activities, whether it is an interest or saving accounts, or they are buying, that's as you said, is to the minimum available in that market, in that society, in that region, then dealing with those companies would be permitted. Those are the very, very general guidelines. Again, it has to be taken on case to case basis and investigate, find out what kind of haram involved and how big or small the percentage of the haram involved.
So in the lease to own contract, it seems like there would be two contracts in one, and I'm wondering if that's prohibited because of that. I mean, there's no interest, which is wonderful, right, because that's a very big sin. But I'm wondering if there's another issue.
Yeah, if you are referring to the hadith of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, where he naha an bay'atayn fi bay'atin, prohibited, you know, from having two contracts in one and one contract, that is correct, but it has a certain application. It's not applied in all cases. Like one of the correct applications of this hadith is that, for example, I will not sell you my car unless you rent me your house. So we're involving a sale contract from one side and the lease contract from the other side. I mean, the combination or the stipulation between those two contracts together is not allowed. Because one of us is taking advantage of the need of the other. I will not give you my car unless you give me your house. So this is a lease from one side and like a sale from the other side, which is not allowed. This is what Prophet ﷺ means by However, if there is if there are two different contracts that are supporting the main purpose of the whole transaction, then that would be allowed. Like, for example, a combination of joint ownership between, for instance, me housing and you as a client, and then ijar, in which you rent their share, okay, on a gradual basis until you buy their share in full. I mean, this is a combination of two different contracts, but it is for your benefit and their benefit, because the main purpose behind establishing that partnership between you and them is to help you buying a house for yourself. You see, that's why having a combination of ijara and ownership together in the same contract, the same agreement, is a lack of honor.
Going back to your example of the car, when you mentioned that you could sell it for $5,000, or if someone wants to finance it, you could sell it for $6,000 or $7,000. Now, suppose you have an identical car, or suppose you have two or more of the same model. Would you have to have a fixed price, or could you increase the price now if someone wants to finance it? Would that be riba?
Can you increase the price for
the price of your car? So you can sell your car for $5,000 and then you have an identical one. Someone wants to finance it. Would you have to sell $5,000 or do you increase the price?
No, I can sell the same car, like another car that is identical, as you said, for a higher price. I mean, it's up to me. يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا تأكلوا أموالكم بينكم بالباطل إلا أن تكون تجارة عن تراض منكم. Or you believe do not devour, you know, the money for another unless it is a trade upon mutual consent. So upon a mutual consent, my first car was sold for $5,000. Upon a mutual consent, my second car was sold for $6,000 for 1 year. Definitely within certain limits. People cannot make an agreement to commit something haram. See, for example, a man and a woman can't make an agreement to do something haram. And we say, well, that's fine because that was done upon mutual agreement, mutual consent, as I said, within certain limits. So this is a bail. I do not see any haram involved in it at all.
I have two questions. One is
regarding
the housing. Option you said, ijara, who buy it for ijara. So how is the risk kind of like when someone is leasing it, how is the entities bearing the risk in this case?
How's that, I'm sorry?
Yeah, you said that you can kind of like take it on the land for the lease for 20 years and then...
I get the question. This is a This is a model finance that holds ijar mutahib tamliki. Again, upon your request, upon your pre-agreement with the bank will buy the property solely, exclusively. It's going to be owned by the bank. You are not a co-owner. They pay 100% of the property. You see? And you start renting. I mean, they will lease their property to you with that agreement that if you successfully pay your rent for 20, 25 years, then the whole property will be transferred, the deed will be transferred for you for $1. That's another scenario that is acceptable.
Okay, but in this case, this has happened to this house or something like that, in that case, it's just that you're just renting over. That's how you can play constantly. Is that the case? That's the,
I didn't get the last one.
No, let's say you're living in that house for 20, supposedly,
okay.
In that house for 25 years. Within that period, somehow, you got destroyed in Alien or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And at that point, you don't have a house to buy or something like that, right? So, is that how the risk kind of like?
Yeah, this scenario, this model finance, if the house gets completely major damage, you would be losing the rent that you paid, and the company would be losing the property itself. So, everybody is losing. That's fair enough.
Another, the same question, and regarding you're talking about the lease price of 20,000 and you are paying 25,000 for a 5-year plan. So in both cases, even if it was kind of like a person interest bearing loan based on that, where kind of like paying installment, it was kind of like after 5 years, how much you were paying, that was fixed, right? It was 25,000.
Regardless of it, as long as there is a mutual agreement from the beginning with a certain price, then everybody has to apply to it.
Okay.
This car is 25,000, instead of 25, instead of 20,000, in order for me to get rid of the APR, make it zero. This is a good option for me and for the seller.
Thank you.
I'll expand upon your Walmart example. Let's say we have a technical tech mutual fund. Its core business is getting the technical stocks, but let's say like 1% or 2% of its stock that it gets a mutual fund is like financial business. So would that be allowed as well? Just like Walmart business is allowed?
As I said, okay, you go with the minimum percent amount goal. First of all, you have to check what is the core business. Under what category Walmart is falling? Is it a liquor store? No. Is it a financial institute? No, it's not.
No, he has something.
It's a.
He has a different person. Saying if you have a mutual fund.
I'm talking about mutual funds.
Mutual fund?
Yes, it's a technical mutual fund.
Technical?
Yeah. So it has 90% tech stocks.
Okay.
And let's say 10% of those stocks are in investment businesses, bank businesses, or some other businesses. Now it's a very similar to Walmart example, but it's now a mutual fund instead of a Walmart business. It's a mutual fund in which 90% of the stocks are tech stocks and 10% are some other stocks, maybe Haram or something else, liquor business or something else. Now, but the core business is technical stocks. So is it permissible to get that in the mutual fund?
It's still actually permissible to have this kind of portfolio for your 401k, even if you know in advance that there's a certain percent is allowable, as long as you cannot avoid it, then you can keep it. But whenever you receive your money, you have to get rid of that certain percent of haram. If you know approximately that 8 or 10% is haram, if you receive, for example, $100,000, then $10,000 has to be getting rid of. But you still can keep the following. I mean, it's not even wise because you give it out because there is some haram going. I mean, this is your right. As you know, your company has to match your paid for any pension or 401k or whatever you can.
Just had a quick question, because I'm not here for presentation. I wanted to just talk about the rights of money upon us. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can trust us with our money. So at a general level, could you talk about the rights of the money upon
the money upon us. Can you just elaborate more?
So for instance, like Nobara talks about, you know, don't use it, like, you know, don't waste money, right? Don't use an extravagance. So, I mean, are we supposed to invest money, right? Isn't that one of the goals of the money that we keep it invested, like not just sitting idle and losing value?
The minimum that you have, I mean, the minimum requirement is to, I mean, if you are in charge of a household or a family, the minimum you can go with is to make sure that you are, you know, sponsoring your family and spending on them accordingly, you are satisfying their need. And if you have extra money, you are as a gap payer, then you have to pay your zakat. When it comes to your personal expenditure, as you said, you have to avoid extravagance, because extravagance is always haram. And the higher level actually is to pay or to donate for the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala more than the zakat. So avoiding extravagance, avoiding consuming anything haram, sponsoring your family if you are in charge, if you are the sponsor, and paying your zakat. This is the right of money upon us. If you
Assalamu alaikum. This question is a few parts, so inshallah, I'll make it simple to you, inshallah, you can answer them all together. The first part is regarding the permissibility of, when you have car insurance, some of them have liability or full coverage. So we would like to touch up on that a little bit. Second part being offered
the job. Okay, let's take them one at a time. As I said yesterday, any kind of, I mean, there is a semi unanimity that any kind of commercial insurance is prohibited, and whatever people need desperately or direly will be excluded from that basic, you know, default rule, except for life insurance. So if you are a medical doctor, for example, and you need desperately to have a business insurance to protect yourself against any like lawsuit from your clients and your patients, you can have it. If you live in a high risk area like in New Orleans, Louisiana, or Houston, Texas, and there is a good possibility of having hurricanes and tornadoes, you can have a house insurance. If you have a driver license, you want to drive your car, you cannot drive it without having liability insurance, you can have it, and on and on. Health insurance, that's another kind of exception. Even if you have to do it yourself, because there is a desperate need for it, because of the very high expense of healthcare in the US. So you go with your need, with the haja. As long as there is a haja, obviously you can excuse yourself. And you know your needs more than anybody else. It depends on your situation, what kind of career, what kind of job, how much you are in need for that insurance. But the life insurance has to be avoided.
And that's the last part, is the life insurance. What happens when you just get a job and that comes with the package they're offering you life insurance?
Yeah.
Is that halal?
Yeah, if the life insurance then comes as a part of the package, you get a package from the company, like a monthly salary and 2 weeks paid vacation and health insurance and life insurance, if it comes automatically as a part of the package, then you can take it. There is a well-known rule. The void transaction will be overlooked if it is included in a valid one. So the main contract that you are signing with your employer is not the life insurance. It is an employment agreement. I mean, you work for that company. Okay? And because of your work, because of the experience and the time that you are exerting there, you get a package. Part of it is the life insurance. So you can, the prohibition of contract or transaction is overlooked because it's a part of a halal contract. So you can take it. But make sure you are not the one who is signing the contract with the life insurance. And your employer is the one who is offering you the life insurance.
So I have a similar question. I'm 4 years old, and I'm 25 off the grid. My son
Speak up, man.
So I'm saying I have the same situation that my company offers like 25 funds. They are a combination of different investment, as the brother mentioned, and precious metals, things like that. None of them were less than 20%. 20% of the share was financial. 80% would be tech, precious metals, you know, energy companies, but none of them were there. So I...
If this is the only option that you have, you just go ahead, take it, and get rid of those 20% if you are sure that the financial or the kind of business within those 20% financial is purely haram, you just get rid of 20% of whatever you will be taking with you to us.
I have another question. The second portion is...
By the way, just to give you a peace of mind, there's a matter I did not hear it from the sheikh directly, but I heard it from someone else. The sheikh said, I trust him a lot. His name is Dr. Yusuf Mishbeh from Saudi Arabia. He was a part of our network committee and they left long time to go back to Saudi Arabia. He said that even if you are sure, 100%, that your investment company is investing your 401k in a pure haram business, you should not care. Because you are not the one who took the decision, they did not consult with you, and they give you the money as a part of the package itself. So just act blind and take the money, and this halal food. This is, I mean, the spirit of this fatwa. Although, I mean, I might disagree with this year, but this is a very bad idea. So, I mean, do not worry. Stay just at the safe side, get rid of the pure haram percentage that, you know, that contaminated your investment.
Most companies give you a default fund if you don't opt out. So you have other options to choose, but if you don't pick an option, they give you an option according to your age.
No, you need to be proactive. I mean, you need to approach the investment company and ask them exactly what you are looking for.
I did.
Do not wait until they decide you will be happy.
Yes, I asked my company to involve certain funds so that they cater, but for including every single fund, they have to pay that's a fidelity extra amount. So they said, we don't
can't
have...
Make it pure, you know, 10% without 20%. I mean, can you change your portfolio?
Yeah, that's the best I could find out of 25 options. They were not willing to get another one until...
Why don't you make it 100% take on? Why you afford 20%?
There is no other option. The only ones they call carry are mixed ones.
As I said, go with the minimum haram the minimum.
I have one more question the brother asked. The saving...
You don't have a 401k.